We are so very, very pleased and happy to have you with us for the beginning of what we suspect will be a very powerful series of meetings. Our speaker is no stranger to the 3ABN audience. He is a preacher of long standing, a preacher of righteousness, dare I say, one who has spent many, many years in the service of the Lord. We are very, very pleased to have Ken Cox back with us. And we know that we're going to get messages that have been prayed over and have been studied, and that will be a blessing to us. Over the last several years, he's been a featured speaker here on 3ABN, and when we travel the country, we always hear that there are so many who are blessed by Pastor Cox and by his presentations as he took us through the book of Revelation. During this series, we go to another very prophetic book, the book of Daniel, and so we know that God is going to bless us in a very, very special way. I'm going to ask you now to bow your heads with me as we pray and as we prepare for the music and the message which is to follow. Gracious Father, we just praise you and thank you so very much for the privilege of serving you. We thank you for the word and for the power of the word and for what we learn when we study the word and how it impacts our lives and makes us stronger in Christ Jesus. And so this night, Father, we ask that you would be with Pastor Cox. Touch his mind as you have so many times in the past. Touch his lips. May the words that he brings to us be meet in due season, but more than that, prepare our hearts, those here in this place and those who are listening and watching around the world. Lord, may we receive not only a blessing, but may we receive information and inspiration, and may we draw a little closer to Jesus. May we be doers of the word, not just hearers. And we thank you in advance for the move of the Holy Spirit that will be in this place this night. In Jesus' name, amen. I lay my sin on Jesus, the spotless Lamb of God. He bears them all and frees us from the accursed load, from the accursed load. I bring my guilt to Jesus to wash my crimson stain. Why? Till not a stain remains, till not a stain remains. I lay my wants on Jesus, all fullness dwells in him. He healeth my diseases. He doth my soul redeem. He doth my soul redeem. Amid the heavenly throng, I lay my sin on Jesus.
Amen. Thank you very much, Brother C.A. Murray, and welcome to Anchors of Truth. And I have looked forward to this tonight. Pastor Kenneth Cox is a Bible student, an evangelist, a pastor, a man who loves God. I've known him for very many years. I've had the pleasure of serving on the board of directors of Kenneth Cox Ministries for years, along with Danny Shelton, who's also a member of that board. I had the privilege of chairing the board for 5 years, and I believe in the ministry of Elder Cox. He has been all over the world. If not physically, he has been through television and by video. His videos preceded his use of television. I remember years ago when Carl Branster came from Australia, and he taped the Kenneth Cox Crusade at that time, and it was distributed all over the world. We have seen so many tremendous results from that ministry and from the videos that have gone around the world. In addition to that, Kenneth, of course, has held hundreds, literally, of crusades. There is probably not another minister in this denomination who has held as many full-fledged evangelistic crusades as Pastor Cox. I remember John Carter and I talking about this one time, and he told me, he said, Kenneth Cox is an evangelist. He is a man who loves the Lord, who loves the message of Jesus Christ, loves the prophecies that God has given to us. And so tonight he is going to be sharing with us on a very important doctrine, one that we've asked him to talk about, the little horn of Daniel, the 7th chapter. We feel that this is very timely, it's important, and this time in the history of this world, for us to be looking at what the Bible says about this prophecy. It's little known by many people, but those who are Bible students know that that little horn is a very big subject. And so tonight, we welcome to this pulpit and to 3ABN, Pastor Kenneth Cox.
Thank you, Jim. Appreciate that. Good evening. Very happy to welcome each of you back again this evening for a series. This series is entitled Anchors of Truth, but it's a series about the rise of the Antichrist. And so those of you who are watching by television, or listening on the radio, or here with us tonight, whichever way it is, we hope that this will bless you in a special way. Now, when I say this series is on the rise of the Antichrist, we're going to be spending 5 subjects on the Antichrist. That's what we're going to be looking at. And so we're going to be taking you through the Bible and what it has to say about the Antichrist. It's a very, very important subject, one and you and I need to understand, as God has revealed much in the Scripture concerning this. In fact, our subject this evening is entitled The Little Horn of Daniel 7. The Little Horn of Daniel 7. God uses many different types of symbolism to identify the little horn, not just one. And therefore, it's necessary that you and I understand what the little horn is, who it is, where it comes from, and the symbolism that represents it. And tonight, the little horn represents the Antichrist. That's what we're talking about and we're going to be looking at. But as we take a look at this subject, in Daniel, it makes a statement, and it says this. It says, just a minute, let me get where I can read it. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, I'll get it right here in a minute. It says, those who are wise. Now, you'll find when it says those who are wise, it's talking about a group of people, a special group of people. And these people are mentioned several places, not just here in Daniel, but it's mentioned in the book of Revelation. It continues in Daniel saying, and he said, go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the what? All right, Daniel 12:9, it says, shut up the book or seal it, for the words are sealed unto the time of the end. Has to be talking about at the end of time before Jesus comes. Listen to what he says here, verse 10. Many shall be purified, made white, refined, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. See, it's referring back to that same word, wise. The wise shall understand. In Hebrew, that word wise is a word called maskilim. This is the word for wise. And when it's talking about the maskilim, these are a group of people. People that are not only wise concerning the scripture, but they're wise in their conduct and how they conduct themselves. And so this is a special group of people. And the Bible's very clear that you and I want to be among these. This group of people are talked about over in Revelation, Revelation 14, verse 12. Here is the patience of the saints. Here are those who keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. John takes this group of people and puts them among these that are of the masculine. Because when you read Revelation 13, 18, it says this. Here is what? Okay, wise. Here are those that are wise. Here is wisdom. What about them? Let him who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man. His number is 666. So when it talks about the beast here, and we'll be studying that in another night or two, that the beast is also that of the Antichrist. Another symbolism that's used for the Antichrist is the beast. And so it says, here is wisdom. Here's the person that's wise, that understands, the masculine. Again, Revelation 17, verse 9 and 10, it says, here is the mind that has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sits. And so we find that the scripture refers to this group of people who are wise. And what you and I need to be tonight is we need to be wise. We need to be among the masculine and understand what it has to say, particularly about the Antichrist. And so tonight, we're going to Daniel, the seventh chapter. We're going to take a look at the little horn, because the scripture identifies the little horn as the Antichrist. Now, this is important, folks, because the scripture says more about this power, about the Antichrist, than it does any other power in all of the scripture. So it's very important that you and I understand what it's saying. So let's go to Daniel 7, verse 3, and it says, and four great beasts came up from the sea, each different from the other. So we have four beasts coming up out of the sea. And again, you're going to see as we continue through the series, these four beasts are important because they set an order that's necessary that you and I understand. Four beasts came up out of the sea, And it says, those great beasts, which are four what? Kings which arise out of the earth. The scripture doesn't leave us in any doubt as to who these four beasts are. And it tells us that the first one was like a lion, had eagle's wings. I watched till its wings were plucked off. It was lifted up from the earth and made to stand on 2 feet like a man, and a man's heart was given to it. So this first one is a lion, has eagle wings, a man has a man's heart, and it stood upon 2 feet. Now, if you went over to the ruins of Babylon of old, you would find that this lion is not something that wasn't pictured there. It was. In fact, Scripture refers to Babylon as the lion. Listen to what it says in Jeremiah 4, verse 7. The lion has come up from the thicket, and the destroyer of nations is on his way. He has gone forth from his place to make your land desolate. Your cities will be laid waste without inhabitants. So, this lion, which was Babylon, was going to come in and destroy many of the nations. Now, what you're looking at there on the screen is a picture of the Ishtar Gate, part of it, I should say. And you'll notice there the lion, and if you look carefully, you can see the eagle's wings there as they're painted on the lion there. This was pictured. This, the British Museum, who came in and did excavation on the ruins of Babylon, found statues of lions with eagle's wings that pictured Babylon of old. Daniel, as he explained this vision, talked about this lion being Babylon. Babylon overthrew the kingdom of Syria in 605 BC. Nebuchadnezzar had taken everything that he could take and had literally lavished it upon the city of Babylon, and it was a marvelous, wonderful kingdom that he had built. And Babylon lasted for a total of 70 years. That's all. 70 years. Nebuchadnezzar ruled 40 of those 70 years. But we continue on, and it talks about another beast. Daniel 7, verse 5. And suddenly another beast, a second like a bear. He was raised up on one side, had three ribs in its mouth, between its teeth, and they said thus to it, arise, devour much flesh. So now we have a bear coming up out of the sea. This bear raises itself up on one side. It has three ribs in its mouth. And this represented the country of Medo-Persia. Darius the Mede and Cyrus the Persian went together and formed a coalition to overthrow the city of Babylon. And thus they went up, Cyrus particularly as the general, went up and surrounded the city of Babylon and overthrew it. This, the Medes and Persians took everything that was before them, kind of like a bear, slow and cumbersome, but they moved in and they took one territory after another. The three ribs in the mouth of this bear represented the three countries that they overthrew, which was Egypt in 535 BC, Babylon in 539 BC, Lydia in 546 BC. They took one country after another and ruled the whole country. Marvelous what God did for the country of Medo-Persia. We'll talk about it. A lot of great people, and I'm talking about God's people, that lived during the time of the Medes and Persians. They served the Lord. They were great witnesses for God. And the country of Medo-Persia had an opportunity to see God like very few others had an opportunity. But after the bear, it says that there was another, and by the way, Medo-Persia overthrew Babylon in 539 B.C. The next one, Daniel 7, verse 6, after this I looked, and there was another like a leopard, which had on its back four wings of a bird. The beast also had four heads, and dominion was given to it. So now we have a beast. It's like a leopard. Instead of having two wings, it has four wings, and it also has four heads. This represented the country of Greece. History tells us clearly, and so does the scripture tell us clearly, that Greece overthrew Medo-Persia. Under the leadership of Alexander the Great, Alexander the Great met Darius of the Medes and Persians on the plains of Arbela in 331 B.C. Darius had over 1 million men. Alexander the Great had 40,000. And by implementing a new type of warfare, Alexander the Great overthrew him. Alexander the Great took everything that was before him. And by the way, it's interesting that it makes the statement in Scripture here that he would rule the world. And he did, basically. Taking his army, marched it clear to the borders of the country of India and to the place that his soldiers refused to go any farther. And they're headed back home. Alexander the Great, 32 years of age, suffering from drunkenness, from malaria. He's lying on a table in the city of Babylon, dying. And as he lays there, his four generals come in, and they said to him, "To who will you give the kingdom?" And he said, "I'll give my kingdom to the strongest." Those four wings on that leopard represented the swiftness with which he took every country that was before him. And the four heads represented Alexander's great four generals, that the kingdom was divided among them. Cassander was divided, and he was given Macedonia and Greece. Lysimachus, Thrace, Bithynia, Ptolemy, Egypt, Seleucus, Syria. They divided up Alexander the Great's kingdom, just exactly as the scripture said they would. Now, you need to follow, folks, and put it down in your memory, because it'll become very important that we've looked at Babylon, Medo-Persia, Greece, three nations. Now we come to the fourth one. And by the way, Greece overthrew Medo-Persia 331 B.C. And the fourth one, it says, "After this I saw in the night vision, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, exceedingly strong. It had large iron teeth," or huge iron teeth. "It was devouring, breaking pieces, and trampling the residue with its feet. It was diverse from all, or different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns." This beast, different than all the others, it says that it devoured everything that was before it, stamped the residue with its feet. It overthrew everything, and this was the kingdom of pagan Rome. Pagan Rome used a different philosophy, whereas Nebuchadnezzar, Cyrus, Alexander, they came in and overthrew one country after another, cities after one after another. But Rome didn't do that. Rome gave them a choice. They told him, "Join us, and we'll give you protection. We'll look after you, care for you, give you protection. We'll make sure that everything's all right, and some of your men will have to go with us as soldiers, but we'll give you part of the spoils, and we'll care for you." And many of them join pagan Rome because of that philosophy. If they didn't, they just trampled right over them, overthrew them. One after another, they took the whole country. And as you remember, pagan Rome is pictured in Scripture as a having great iron teeth, as it devoured one thing. And you remember it was under pagan Rome that the children in Bethlehem were slain. You also remember it was under pagan Rome that Jesus was born. Jesus was born at that time for a definite reason and purpose, folks. You see, Rome was not only, how should I put it, would devour everything before it, was cruel, it did a lot of things it shouldn't, but it also did something else. It made the highways, the waterways, and all safe. It basically, even as bad as Rome was, she brought civilization to the world because all of a sudden people could travel where they never could before. And Jesus Christ was born at this particular time in history because it opened up the way for the gospel to be taken to the world, where before it could not be done. Now, it was possible, and it spread throughout the world, and the crucified, risen Savior was preached, and the church literally multiplied by the thousands because the gospel was made possible. Rome overthrew Greece, 168 B.C. Now, we come to the next part. And it was different. This beast was different from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns. So this particular beast is different in the fact that it has 10 horns. You see, at this time in history, 457 B.C., Rome has grown, how should I put it, maybe I should say old. She's having trouble holding her kingdom together. She's ruled longer than any other kingdom, but she's just struggling. And they've taken the capital and moved it from Rome to Constantinople. And all of a sudden, north, the Germanic tribes that lived in the north, they were people called the Goths. They began to move down on the Roman Empire. And as they moved down on the Roman Empire, they broke it to pieces. They were such people as the Anglo-Saxons and the Franks and the Heruli and the Vandals and the Ostrogoths. And they broke up the Roman Empire. These 10 nations, tribes, whatever you want to call them, became the nations of Western Europe. The 10 horns are 10 what? Kings who shall arise from where? Who shall arise from this kingdom. The scripture is very clear exactly where it's going to arise from. They were the Alemanni, the Ostrogoths, the Visigoths, the Franks, and so forth. And these, as I mentioned, became the nations of Western Europe. Now, follow me carefully, because all of a sudden there's a metamorphosis that begins to take place here that you need to understand. Daniel 7, verse 8. I was considering the horns, okay? And there was another horn, a little one, coming up among them, before whom 3 of the first horns were plucked out by the roots. And there in this horn were eyes like the eyes of a man, and a mouth speaking pompous words. So now, all of a sudden, among those 10, a little horn is coming up. Now listen to all that the scripture says about this little horn, because it says more about this power than it does any other power in scripture. The 10 horns are 10 kings who shall arise from this kingdom. Let's clarify, when it says shall arise from this kingdom, what kingdom is it talking about? Pagan Rome. So it says it shall rise from pagan Rome, and another shall rise after them. He shall be different from the first ones, and shall subdue 3 kings. He shall speak pompous words against the Most High, shall persecute the saints of the Most High, and shall intend to change times and laws. Then the saints will be given into his hand for a time, and a half a time. So, this little horn is going to do definite things, and the scripture gives you 8 points of identifying this little horn. And this little horn, as far as the scripture is concerned, is the Antichrist. So listen to them. Make sure you understand what they are. One, it says it would rise among them. Two, it says it would be after them. Three, it says it would be different. Four, it says it would uproot 3 horns. Five, mouth speaking great things. War with the saints. Changing times and laws. Rule for 1260 years. We're going to look at those 8 points rather quickly, but they're important that you understand what they are. Okay, Daniel 7, verse 8. I was considering the horns, and there was another horn, a little one, coming up among them. Now, where is that little horn coming up? It's coming up among them, among the ten. Folks, those Germanic tribes, Anglo-Saxons, the Franks, and all those are the countries of Western Europe. So you and I don't need to go looking over in Africa for the little horn, or we don't need to go look into India, but it says it would come up among those 10 horns. So it tells us where it's going to come up. So it's located the place for us. Two, another shall rise after them. Scripture says here, I shouldn't say history, scripture, history says here, Vigilius ascended the papal chair 538 A.D. under the military protection of Belisarius. Okay, be real clear that Vigilius, who was the bishop of Rome, ascended to the papal chair when? 538 A.D., important date. Okay, this is what history says about it. And he shall be different from the first one. These 10 Germanic tribes that came down on pagan Rome were strictly political powers. They were just pagan powers. They didn't have anything else. But now, all of a sudden, there is a power that is rising that's different. It's not like the others. There has been a change taking place. And this is what we're told in history took place. It says, the bishop of Rome in the seat of Caesar was now the greatest man in the West and was soon forced to become the political as well as the spiritual head. To the Western world, Rome was still the political capital. Hence the whole habit of mind, all ambition, pride, and the sense of glory, and every social prejudice favored the evolution of the great city in the ecclesiastical capital. Civil as well as religious disputes were referred to the successor of Peter for settlement. So what it says now is the Bishop of Rome has taken the seat of Caesar. History says that the Bishop of Rome stepped to the seat of Caesar and grasped the scepter 538 A.D. Now, there's a real difference here, folks, that takes place. All these others were civil powers. A church has no power. A church has no power to enforce its beliefs. Do you understand what I'm saying? A church has no power. It can preach it. It can do all that kind of thing, but it cannot force it. The only way it can force it is by accepting civil power. And that's what it says happened here when papal Rome accepted civil power. And thus that particular horn was different than all the rest. He shall subdue 3 kings. Of these Germanic tribes that came down on the Roman Empire, 3 of them, the Ostrogoths, the Heruli, and the Vandals, accepted the belief called Arianism. And they believed that Jesus Christ was a good man, but they did not believe that he was divine. And Justinian, who was the emperor, had committed himself to defend the church. And so under Justinian and the papal power, they went in and wiped out the Heruli, the Vandals, and the Ostrogoths. Now, it says it would uproot them. That means pull them out by the roots. There'd be nothing left. That's what that means. And you can find descendants for all these other, the Alemanni are the Germans, the Franks are the French, and so forth. But there are no descendants to the Ostrogoths, the Heruli, and the Vandals. They pulled them up literally by the roots. And he shall speak pompous words against the Most High. He's going to go a step farther, and he's going to speak words against God. That's what it's saying. Pompous words against the Most High. Fifth Lateran Council. This is what it says. Thou art the shepherd. Thou art the physician. Thou art the director. Thou art the husband. Finally, thou art another God on earth. In other words, they're taking the place of God. It says, thou art another God on earth. This is not just one statement. There's lots of them. Hence, the Pope is crowned with a triple crown as King of heaven and of earth and of the lower regions. Crowned as the King of heaven, earth, and underneath the earth. One more. Encyclical letter of Pope Leo XIII. We, the Pope, hold upon this earth the place of God Almighty. Now, folks, what we're doing is we're just looking at the points the Scripture gives to identify the Antichrist, and I hope that you understand that word Antichrist does not mean against, because we many times take the word anti to mean against. That's not what it means. It means in place of. That's where the Antichrist in that particular point means in place of. Just exactly what's being said here, placing themselves in the place of God. And shall persecute the saints of the Most High. This power would persecute God's people. Much has been written about this down through the years, showing that great persecution has taken place against God's people. Here's a historical statement that says John Huss, I don't know how many of you ever read about John Huss, great preacher, great man of God, a Bohemian preacher of the Reformation, was burned at the stake on 6 July 1415. Burned him at the stake because of his preaching of righteousness by faith. Pope Martin V issued a bull on the 17th March 1420, which proclaimed a crusade for the destruction of the Wycliffeites, the Hussites, and all other heretics in Bohemia. Persecution. Historians tell us that they have slain millions upon millions of people. In fact, so much was done, and so many people lost their lives in such cruelty against those that follow the Lord, and particularly in the time of the Reformation, that Pope John Paul, on May the 24th, 1995, made a public apology to the world for what they had done. Just as the Scripture says, they would wear out the saints of the Most High, and they have literally done that. So what I'm trying to get across to you this evening is history bears out, as well as the Scripture, that this particular little horn meets all the qualifications of that of the Antichrist. It meets those. Okay, Daniel 7:25. And he shall intend to change times and laws. I want to make a distinction between times and laws. You see, God is the only one who has the prerogative, who has the power to change times. God's the only one that can do that. No one else. That is part of His divinity, part of Him being God, is the power to change times. When the Pope comes in and says that he has the right to set up kings and to take them down, he is usurping that right of time. God's the only one that sets them up, the scripture says. It says that God is the one that sets up kings and takes them down, not the Pope. So that right does not belong to him at all. It also says not only would he do that, but he would change the law and change the times and laws. Listen to this statement. The Pope has power to change what? Times, to abrogate laws, and to dispense with all things, even the precepts of Christ. He has the power to do this. Just as the scripture said, he would think to change times, and he's done that. But it also says he would make an effort to change law. The greatest law that has ever been given to mankind is that of the moral law, the Ten Commandments. Any nation who has upheld those ten principles and taught them to their people has been a great nation. God help us when we turn our back on them. But the power, and there is a difference here, folks, if you pick up a American Catholic Revised version of the Bible, or you pick up a Douay version of the Bible, it will read, when it comes to Exodus 20, where the Ten Commandments are, it will read almost word for word to what your Bible says. Very little difference. When you pick up a catechism, that changes. They have done away with the second commandment. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven images or carved images. They've taken that out of the Bible, or out of the catechism. They not only did that, but they took the fourth commandment and moved it up so that it now became the third commandment, and they shortened it from 94 words to 8 words. They changed it completely, made a change there. And then, because now they were one commandment short, they only had 9, they went and they took the 10th commandment and they divided it into 2 to give them 10 commandments. And thus they have changed the law of God. They've changed times as God said they would. Not only have they done this, but it says, then the saint shall be given unto his hand for a time and times and a half a time. Going to be given into the hand of who now? Get this clear. The saint shall be given to his hand. Who's his hand? Well, it's talking about the little horn. Given into his hand. The Antichrist shall be given to his hand for a time, times, and a half a time. Well, in the Bible, the word time is a Hebrew word that means 1 year. That's what it means, 1 year. And in the biblical reckoning of time, There are 360 days in a biblical year. And if you want to go to Genesis, the 11th chapter, right there, it will make it very clear that there are 360 days in a biblical year. So if I've got time, that means I have 1 year. If I have times, I've got 2 years, which now is 720 days. And if I have a half a year, that's a half of 360, which is 180. If I add those together, it gives me 1,260. So it says it would be given into his hand for 1,260. That's what it says. Well, we find that in the Bible, one day represents a year. Ezekiel 4:6 says, I have laid on you a day for each year. Also, Numbers 14:34 tells you, I have given you a day for a year. So if I have a day for a year, and I've got 1,260 days, that gives me how much? 1,260 years. Now, folks, if this book is true, which I believe it is with all my heart, then when God says it's going to be given into his hand for a time, times, and a half a time, then it has to work out. I mean, God doesn't make those statements and it not work. Well, let's see what happened. What did I tell you? When did the papal power come into rule? Yeah. 538 A.D., Vigilius, under the military of protection of Belisarius, stepped to the throne. 538 A.D. If I add 1,260 years to 538 A.D., that takes me to where? 1798. So it's saying that it would be given into his hand for 1,260 years. Then something had to happen. Something had to take place. 1798. And history tells us this is what happened. This is what took place. Napoleon Bonaparte is ruling. Napoleon wants to rule all of Europe. In fact, Napoleon said, Europe was soon to become one nation. That was his wish. That was his desire. That's what he wanted to do. But Napoleon realized that he could not do that, could not accomplish it, unless he broke the back of the papal power. Because the papal power held tremendous control and sway in all of Europe. They owned papal states, many papal states, that were as large as some of our states here in the United States. They owned them. And therefore, Napoleon realized he had to do something. So, 1798, Napoleon sent his general, Berthier, into Italy, made his entrance into Rome, abolished the papal government, and established a secular one, exactly as the scripture said, at the end of 1,260 years, there the papal power came to its close. Just as the scripture said. Now, folks, what you've got to understand here is this isn't the end. This is the end right here. But the Bible picks it up and continues on talking about the Antichrist and carries it clear down to the coming of Christ. So what you and I have to understand is what's involved here. But he established a secular government in place of it. I want you to see, as far as I'm concerned, Daniel, the 7th chapter, is one of the clearest chapters there is in the Bible that tells you exactly what is to happen and take place. Watch this carefully. If you look at Daniel, the 7th chapter, it talks about three things. It talks about the little horn. It talks about judgment beginning. and it talks about the coming of Jesus Christ. Watch how Daniel puts all that together, folks. Daniel 7, verse 8. And there was another horn, a little one. So he's talking specifically about the little horn. Now, as we move to verse 9, watch what he says. I watched till thrones were put in place, and the Ancient of Days was seated. So all of a sudden, Daniel is saying, here the little horn is. We find the little horn goes down in 1798, and then it says what was to happen. He says the judgment was seated. The judgment started. The Ancient of Days was seated. That's what he says happened. If you took a line and drew it right from where the end of the little horn is, straight down, and took everything on that side of it, the Scripture classifies that period of time as the time of the end. That's where you and I are living, in the time of the end. The little horn came to an end when? 1798. And the Scripture is saying clearly, after 1798, the judgment would begin. That's what he's saying. And then Daniel 7:14, and it says, then to him was given dominion and glory and a kingdom. So it says, after the judgment, what's going to happen? Amon, are you afraid to say? It says, after the judgment, what's going to happen? God is going to set up his kingdom. That's what it's saying. Then to him, that word him there is capitalized. To him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom. Let's go on down to verse 21. Watch Daniel do the same thing again. I was watching, and the same horn was making war against the saints. This is a little horn. He's making war with the saints. He came to his end in 1798. Watch what happens. Verse 22. This is verse 21. Now we're going to verse 22. Until the Ancient of Days came and a judgment was made in favor of the saints. So it's saying as soon as the papal power went down, the judgment was going to start. And then it says, after the judgment, verse 22, and the time came for the saints to possess the kingdom. What's in front of you, folks? The kingdom. That's what it's saying. After that is the kingdom. Oh, let's go on. One more. Daniel 7:24. And another shall rise after them, that's the little horn, and he shall be different from the first. And we found out the little horn rose after them. He was definitely different than the first. Okay, 1798 came to an end. Then something was to happen. Listen to verse 26. And the court shall be seated. Now listen. And they shall take away his. When was his dominion taken away? 1798. And then the court shall be seated. The judgment begins. That's what it's telling you. So what I'm trying to get across to you tonight is understand the order of events. Because there's going to be that of the Antichrist. Then you're going to have the time that the Scripture refers to as the time of the end in which you and I are living in tonight. That's where we are. And during that time, the judgment is going to take place. And after that's over, Jesus is going to come. Verse 27, his kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and all dominions shall serve and obey him. So God's going to come, set up his kingdom. That's where we are. So this is the order I want you to see, because the Scripture repeats this over and over. And if you keep this order clear in your mind, you will not be led astray. Okay, one, you have the kingdom of Babylon. After Babylon, you have Medo-Persia. After Medo-Persia, you have Greece. After pagan Rome, you have papal Rome. after papal Rome went down, you have the judgment. And after the judgment's over, Jesus is coming back. That's the order of events that the Scripture gives. And you and I must be among this special group of people. Many shall be purified, made white, and refined, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. So I hope tonight that you will be among the wise and understand, because our next presentation, we're going to take a look at the beast in Revelation 13, the beast of Revelation 13, because it picks up where we left off tonight, and it tells you things that are going to happen, and you and I need to understand that, because it tells us about the work of the Antichrist right down here at the end of time. So we hope you'll follow each evening as we take a look at God's Word and what it says about the Antichrist. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you. Thank you for your Word. Thank you that we can understand where we are in the stream of time, understand what's taking place. Give us wisdom, give us understanding, that we may be among the wise. Amen.